Right, it is 1, 2, 3 with Mike. It's just coming up to 1:10. I'm delighted to welcome my special guest today. I really want to say, not the son of Steve Howe, I'd like you to be the famous one, because I'm sure you're a bit fed up being introduced as the son of Steve Howe. Howe should be introduced as the father of Dylan. That's what
that's
we're looking
for. More like it.
Thanks. Absolutely more like it. First of all, thanks for coming in
thanks
today.
Thanks for having me. No, great.
Real pleasure. And, well, how are you and what are you up to?
I am well. I'm just sort of driving around today. I've got a few interviews to do, and just got a day off really, so enjoying the sun.
Right, let's come back to the very, very beginning. As a child,
yes,
your father, you were a child. Your father, a very, very famous man indeed. Mm-hmm. For those who don't know, Dylan's father is Steve Howe, who is probably one of the greatest guitar players ever. If you draw up a list of 5 great guitar players, I think your father would be there. What's the latest with Yes? They're still going in some various forms.
Touring a lot. Yeah, what they're doing at the moment, and they have been doing for quite a few years, is they've been playing with. It's an original lineup minus John Anderson. So it's Alan White, Chris Squire, and my dad, and Jeff Downs on keyboard.
Right. So and the original lineup, of course, John Anderson and Rick Wakeman.
Yeah.
So you must have grown up around these people.
I saw. They're all my kind of uncles, really, in a way. Really, I was with them ever since I was a kid, really, and what do you say?
Is Rick Wakeman really a grumpy old man?
No, he's a great raconteur, and he's most probably kind of one of the most approachable of all of them, really. All of them are just interesting guys, really, that have spent a long time in like public eye, and they've been doing. Really, really good thing. So,
Were you aware of the fame and what they did? Did you think, hang on, my dad doesn't go to work from 9 to 5 like all my friends' dads do?
Yeah, it's funny that. Yeah, I think the first time I realised that he was unusual was I went to a gig, might have been my first ever gig. I was about 5, and I went to the Rainbow to see Yes play, I hadn't seen my dad for a while that day, and then suddenly he's on the stage playing the guitar, and all these people are kind of applauding and standing up, and I'm like, oh, he's on the stage and he's playing, and everyone's going mad, and it was then that the penny dropped, really. I was like, okay, so this is unusual, this is great.
And that was time to put your chest out and say, ha, that's my dad on stage as a 5-year-old, I'm sure it was. Yeah.
Well, I definitely felt proud of him. I always do, and so I suppose that was when I realised that that was his job.
And the second question is do you actually really like Yes's music?
I love Yes's music, yeah, especially the first sort of 3 or 4 albums that he's on. I'm still into those. I mean, they're still on my sort of all-time list.
They're still on your iPod.
iPad player, yeah. Really. Because they stand up and they're sort of immortal in a way. They're kind of, they're all at their prime, and they were doing something really interesting and individual. So above all,
they were very, very talented musicians, all of them, weren't they?
Is the thing. I think if it can work. I mean, it was interesting actually, because about a month ago or something, I kind of asked my dad, how did you record those albums, and did you know what you had at time? And the interesting thing was that he said, I think the reason that it sounded like that and it is so good is we didn't realize really what we were doing, but what we had at that point. It was all just in the moment, and it just felt like a natural thing for them. So they were all of a like mind, and so it's just that thing of kind of chemistry everything's happening at the same time to everyone at the same time, and that's what can happen.
And it wasn't, to be fair, I mean, Yes were or still are an acquired taste. Not everybody's cup of tea. They've got a massive, massive following, and their contemporaries like ELP and Pink Floyd at the same time.
It's sort of strange for me. I feel like there still should be a time soon when they are appreciated more, because you get a lot of groups from 30, 40 years ago and have like a resurgence, and
especially the Floyd at the moment.
And everyone's into them, yeah, and suddenly, it's okay to like them again, kind of thing. But I think with prog music and... there's still a barrier, sort of saying, "Oh, am I supposed to like this, or is it? It's not. Is it? They really haven't had the due that they should yet."
And I must say as well, it's rare to hear a Yes record apart from going for the one on the radio.
It's funny. I mean,
and there's plenty out there.
Yeah, I mean, there are songs that are shorter, that you know, have a chorus, you know, like Roundabout and stuff, and that don't have a lot of sections at it, and it's so long. But I think with anything that's good, it's not immediate for everybody, but once you spend a bit of time and you think, hang on, I'm going to check this out, you're going to go somewhere that you haven't gone, so it's worth it. Yeah.
I'm sure you've answered this question many times before. I'm still going to ask it though.
Go on.
Why are you a drummer and not a guitarist?
Well, it might be an accident. It might be. I think it's a few things. I think there was a drum kit upstairs in our house, in my dad's studio upstairs. And I just started messing around in it, and then we started to kind of jam together, so there was this thing where it was easy to do that. And I think when I used to see Yes, because the drums are a very immediately visual instrument, you know, you can kind of see how they're able to play the thing, and it's as all of the movements are exaggerated, I suppose, yeah, and sort of open, then I would always watch Alan and stuff, and I think I might be able to do that, maybe, you know. And so I just had this sort of natural gravitation to the drums,
And you had two mentors there, didn't you? You mentioned Alan White, there's Bill Bruford as well.
And Bill, very, very much. I mean,
following those footsteps, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, you know, isn't it great to be around that sort of inspirational playing and those sort of people? Really, it's it's great. I'm really lucky.
I'm going to play a song by your father now that I've sat probably for the last probably 30 years with a guitar and not got past note 5 without making
you
a mistake.
Must have got further.
No,
than
I'm
that.
Useless. I am the worst guitar player. No, I can't. And if I try and sing and play at the same time, one stops.
Well, so that is quite difficult.
Yeah, I'm probably the world's worst musician. I love to play along to records, but and I tried for years to play along with the whole of the Yes album. I could go dun 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 dun.
Well, that's a start.
And that's where it stopped. That's as far as we got. Right, this is a song called "The Clap." It's recorded live, I believe. You'll know more where than I do.
It's actually called "Clap."
Not the clap.
It's not, because that is something which
there's
is
the clap
which
here.
Is even more irritating than the, you know, "How's Your Dad" stuff. That was a sort of typo, really.
I read somewhere.
Let's just clear that up now.
All right, it's called "Clap," and apparently it was written for you. Is that,
it
is that
was,
true?
It was. Yeah, I think he played this version you're about to play now. Live version. I think I'd just been born like a couple of weeks before that or something. So.
I've got a feeling it was recorded at the Rainbow. I could be wrong, but it would have been about 1970 something, wouldn't it?
Well, I was born in 69, so yeah.
Oh, maybe earlier than. Oh, well,
could
obviously
have been the beginning of 70 or something. Yeah.
Listen to this.
idea was from her kind of seeing that after gigs, a lot of people would come up to me, and the first thing they would say is, "How's your dad?" And so it's just sort of a humorous way into that life, really, because, you know, total strangers come up to you and say, "How's your dad?" Well, "How's your dad?"
Yeah, exactly.
But there is an assumed kind of ownership or association because I can understand in a way, because, you know, a lot of these people have been following that whole thing and Yes and everything that my dad's done for so long that's the first thing in their minds, really, when you kind of think, well, that's all very nice and everything, but I just played as well.
What about me? Yeah, exactly. You're an artist on your own right.
Yeah, it just kind of it makes you smile a bit and just think, okay, so, but maybe that's the reason they were there anyway, so I have to say thank you, for having the curiosity to come down. So the book is just sort of opening that up, really, and just having a look at a lot of the myths and sort of ideas of that kind of thing, where a lot of people think that, you know, offspring of musicians and rock stars, it's sort of an easy life and everything's sort of there for you, and it's just all of the doors are opening, or everything's kind of easy, and well, it isn't really. So
I'm sure so it isn't. And right, this is a final question, because I'm going to ask you this. You might not even know the answer. The Yes album, which I've forgotten what it's called now. But anyway, you lived in Switzerland for a while, didn't you?
Yeah, you're talking about Going for the Money.
Going for the Money, of course I am. Yeah. There's an organ section there with Rick Wakeman, which rumour has it that you used the Swiss telephone service to record across from the church to the studio because the Swiss telephone service was so good. Is that complete and utter rubbish?
I've never heard of that, but I could imagine it's true. I mean, that doesn't seem like the thing anyone's going to make up, and you know, they're quite organised over there, so they can probably do it.
Okay, that is the final question. We're going to come back and talk about the Steve Howe Trio in a little while. Just before we do, I want to talk about you. You've been involved with Ian Dury, a neighbour of mine, but I never met him. He lived in Upminster, and I had tickets for his gig, sadly, just before he died. But there you go. So how did you get involved with Ian Dury?
Well, I knew Chaz Jankel because I think I did a studio session for him on some tracks that he was doing, and then I think the drummer in the Blockheads at that point, Steve Monty, he had a tour that he had to do, I think, with a band called Curve or something, so there was a gig that he wasn't able to do, and then I just got this call out of the blue just saying, are you free in a couple of weeks, we've got this gig, it's the group called Ian Jimmy and the Blockheads.
And you went, no, let me just check my diary.
And then it was good because I you know, just sort of scored all of the tunes out all and we just did a couple of, well, we did like 1.5 afternoons really of rehearsal, and it just seemed to gel really, and it just seemed to click, and Ian seemed happy, and then for the thing that I thought was just going to be one show, it turned out to be 13 years of stuff, you know. So
take Ian Dury out of the equation for a moment. The Blockheads were known in the public world as just a really, really good tight band as well.
Well, it's true, isn't it, really? I mean, when I was young, you know, that was the impression I always had, and I mean, yeah, if you hear any of their stuff, you can tell that these guys can play, and they're kind of musicians really, aren't they? Yeah. And so it's just it was an honor to, you know, to be involved with them really, and to you know, like, learn and just get into that.
And was he in the sort of madcap character that he portrayed on stage, or was he off stage quite a quiet, reserved man?
Well, I mean, everyone's a lot of different people, aren't they, I suppose, but he he's just a very individual, you know, funny, kind of intelligent.
Judy's sort of,
well, I mean, if you saw him, he doesn't look ill at all. I mean, actually, he looks more well than he's looked for since I've known him. It's a very bizarre sort of,
right, okay, and he's just going to keep on until he feels he can't anymore.
This is it, yeah. I mean, we thought, you know, end of March with our tour, then that was going to be it, and that was everything. But then, like, a month went by, and he was like, "Well, I feel all right. What should I do? You know, I'm a bit bored now. Let's just do some more gigs." So
yeah,
we found it was it was easy to do festival gigs, because if at last minute he's not sort of able to do it, then it can still go ahead. So that's what we've been doing, really. We were in Japan and then all over the country doing some festival stuff, really. So and there's one more next week up in near to Bradford on Saturday, and then another gap, isn't it, really? It's do we do more, or I think that the at the moment I think that the party line is, yeah, we
You just carry, yeah. Why not? Why not?
End of September, maybe, or something.
And how's it for you? As you know, with Zoe, you know, you're abroad a lot, touring. Obviously, you just mentioned Japan. You know, is that difficult? Does she come with you sometimes?
Well, sometimes she's able to come with me, and other times, you know, Skype is just really good.
Oh, it's just brilliant.
Switch it on. It's free and there's cameras. So,
and of course, she's very busy herself as well.
She's doing great, isn't she? She's just doing whole load of books and stuff and
her own music
on a roll and she's also a drummer as well. She's in
I'm glad I don't live next door to you.
Yeah. Our neighbours are really like
the bloody house I am again. Bang 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 bang.
Yeah. The story of my life though.
I'm sure.
Yeah.
Okay, and standing aside from everybody else, you've also done a couple of projects of your own, and you're how would you classify yourself? Jazz fusion? Jazz fusion.
No, it's straight head jazz, really. Kind of inspired by Blue Note stuff or Impulse. So kind of late 60s American influenced jazz, really. I've been leading group since for over 10 years really now. It's good.
And you haven't worked out what you want to do when you leave school, sort of thing. That now that you're there and your dad didn't say get a proper job, son, did he? Or did he?
I did have a couple of jobs but not that long after school, actually, because I only had to work kind of like a kind of day job for like 2 or 3 years or something, and then I was a professional musician.
Fantastic, yeah. Fantastic. Right, you're working with your dad. I promise we wouldn't mention him again, but we are. Because you are in the Steve Howe Trio.
Oh, yes.
And you're gigging, and you're playing at the Thameside on September the 11th.
That's September the 11th.
It's
going to be a good one.
It'll be a good one. Okay, ticket prices?
They are very reasonable.
I haven't got a clue.
I think actually, if it on the night, £20. I think if you're a student, it's a tenner. I think if you go online, it's probably a bit cheaper.
I've got the box office
probably
number.
Something like that. Yeah. And I think we go on sort of 7:45 or something. So it's an early one. No support, and we are going to be touring the UK from the 6th of September, and we've got 11 shows. Wherever you are.
So what's in the set? What can an audience expect?
It's good, really. It's a kind of combination of, it's a Hammond trio. So we've adapted some Yes songs, some stuff like Siberian Katru, Close to the Edge, and others. And then some of solo stuff of my dad, and then also kind of interestingly the things that he was into when he first started playing. So he was into like Jimmy Smith and Wes Montgomery and Kenny Burrell and stuff. So you'll get a kind of cross section of jazz, blues, and then more of the kind of progressive stuff. It's a good kind of set of stuff, which is interesting.
I can't wait to see it. I'm going to ask you another question about your dad, and I apologize.
I don't mind. That's what
is he, I'm going to say, does he still write? Does he still sit there and tinker?
He's doing loads of, he's just very prolific, really. He's just kind of seems to always have ideas and want to do stuff, and he's got quite a few solo albums, and it's good because he's sort of active, creatively and live, and so he's still got a lot of energy, really, and he's
brilliant,
just
brilliant.
into music. I mean, it's just
just can't wait, mate. And
forever.
Just finally, thank you very much for coming in. It's been a real pleasure to talk to you.
Yeah,
and
great.
I wish you real luck with the gig. Is there a website we can find out where you're on tour around the country?
Yeah, I think if you go to stevehowe.com, I'm sure everything's there, or to my
You don't know
site
prices,
well.
You don't know.
Well, it's not my job,
not
is
your
it?
Job,
yeah,
no,
is it
no,
someone
no.
else's job today?
Exactly. Dylan, thank you so
Thanks
much.
Lot,
and I
yeah.
really appreciate it. And we'll see you on September the 11th and at the Thameside Theatre in Thurrock. we'll have to end with some more Yes, I'm afraid.
Great. What are you going to play?
Paul tells me off all the time for playing this, but even better when it's not working. Why is that working? Oh, I don't know. It's not working. Let's try something else. Dear. Well, I can tell you why that wasn't working.
What are you going to play?
That's better.
Good.
That's better. I pressed the wrong button.
Good.
Better yours is no discussion. Dylan, thank you very much again. Have a safe journey, and we'll see you on the 11th.
Thanks a lot. Thanks.